approximately 3:45 this afternoon, as I was emerging from the croissant shop, your son and another boy absconded with two of my hubcaps.
Oh, no. Officer, there must be a mistake. Mm-hmm. No?
No.
Oh, I don't know what to say. I'm so sorry. We're not that kind of family, really. I am a solid tax-paying citizen. I am also a member in good standing of the Oakwood Country Club. Right, Mother?
I've never seen this woman before in my life.
Hello. Welcome back to...
Oh, hey. Hey, yo.
This is the Boss Podcast.
I like trying to time those out.
Yes.
I'm literally playing it on a laptop computer as I'm doing it live.
Yeah. It's not like an audio board.
No, this is
not a fancy
setup. This is all live, folks.
Here.
We don't mess around.
Right. I'm Tori.
And I'm Kevin.
And we are here to rewatch and discuss every single episode of Who's the Boss. This episode, we're focusing on season 1, episode 20, named Just Like Tony. It first aired March 12th, 1985. And the TV Guide summary says, when Jonathan starts picking up Tony's bad habits, Angela demands to be consulted on anything regarding her son.
Demands.
It was written by Ken Cinnamon, which I just want to say that is a fantastic name, and Karen Wengrod. This episode opens with Angela and Mona struggling to put plastic covers on a couch.
I know. What's going on there? It's like Dexter Kill plastic. Yes. And it doesn't like... I remember when my grandmother had plastic on her couch. It didn't look like that. It actually looked good.
I mean,
for plastic on the couch, it looked good.
My grandma had it too. I don't really remember it, but I remember it being a pretty snug fit.
Yeah, this is like they're trying to put a poncho over a couch.
But Tony comes downstairs and he's like, oh, Beeman plastic covers. And he knows that you just need to rip one side and then it goes right on. And he's like, these are fantastic. Everyone in Brooklyn has them.
But still, I'm sweating looking at it.
I know. I'm so glad that that's not a thing anymore. I couldn't imagine.
No. It was terrible.
Now, Mona and Angela, of course, being from Connecticut, have no idea about slipcovers. But Jonathan comes downstairs. He's excited to show his mom what he's going to show off at school for show and tell. He opens up his shirt, and there is a hula girl tattoo on his chest.
Which makes no sense.
I know. And he's like, look, it's just like Tony's. And he's like, watch her wiggle.
I know. And then he's like, maybe when I get older.
Yeah, because nothing's wiggling. Right. He's trying real hard. But
what's going to wiggle when he gets older? Does that mean?
Well, I guess he'll have like muscles, so maybe he could.
Oh, yeah. That's one way to go with it.
Roll the muscles and make her move around some more. Angela's not at all impressed with the hula girl or her wiggle. And she's like, you are not showing that off at school. So he's like, well, what am I going to bring? So she hands him like a carving from the table behind the couch and is like, how about this authentic Chinese carving?
Right.
To which we get the first like terrible stereotypical racist kind of joke from Mona, which is... do you get egg roll with that?
It's like, oh no.
No, we're not. I mean, it's the 80s. You know, you know more and then you do better.
I mean, at least she didn't do an accent.
Right. But the fact that she said, do you get egg roll with that?
Right.
Implies that she was kind of...
an accent, like broken English.
Right.
Right.
But, I mean, you know, it's the 80s. We can't really hold our standards today with that, but that is a joke you would never see on television today.
Yeah, I mean, it is the 80s. I'm surprised 20 episodes in, we haven't seen all kinds of racism, more sexism peppered into this show.
Right.
I mean, considering.
Yeah. But yeah, so that was a little bit of a wah-wah.
Yeah.
But fast in. So Jonathan decides he's going to take Tony's baseball cap for the major leagues. Which is super cute. He goes running upstairs to get it.
Yeah.
And Tony says, the kid idolizes me.
Yes.
Which is absolutely true. And Angela's like, listen, if he ever comes home with a real tattoo, and Tony's like, we'll make sure it says mom.
Yeah.
So the next day, Jonathan comes home from school, and he has a little puffy jacket on, and there's something underneath the jacket. And he comes in, and he's like, Samantha, hit me as hard as you can. this is your favorite part.
Oh, my God. I think I played this over how many times? 20 times?
Yeah. So, I don't know if this is exactly where her little punch was supposed to land, or if it was supposed to be this hard, but Alyssa Milano nails him in the shoulder, and he kind of falls back into Tony Danza.
Yeah.
And like you were saying, it almost is as if Tony Danza is a little worried. Yeah, like are you okay?
Yeah, like, because it looks like she punches him right in the face almost. Like, she really gives him a right hook.
She really does, yeah. He falls right back into him. So, Jonathan's like, no, not him there. Like, hit me here. And he knocks on the front of his jacket, and there's something hard and metal underneath it.
Right.
So, he pulls it out from his jacket, and it is a hubcap.
Of course, he has a hubcap shoved in his Mets jacket.
And he and Joey Dinkman stole this hubcap off of a Oak Hills patrol car. So not technically the police, but like a neighborhood
cop.
Neighborhood patrol, yeah.
Yeah.
Now Tony's like, what? What did you do? Why do you have this? And he tells him it's stealing. And Jonathan's like, well, I kind of got the idea from you because you told me when you were a kid you used to steal street signs. And Tony's like, yeah, but I was dumb. And, you know, Jonathan's like, so am I. And yeah. He's like, and my dad, you know, made me stay in the police station overnight when I got caught to teach me a lesson. So Jonathan, that doesn't sound so good to Jonathan.
No.
And he's like, I'm sorry, and I'll never do it again, and goes upstairs. So Tony tells him, you know, go think about what you did. Now, Tony asks Sam, I love when Tony goes to Sam for advice. This is the second time we've seen that. And he's asking her, like, how am I going to break this to Angela? And Sam's like, why don't you just not tell her? Because that's what Mom and I used to do when I would do bad things and we didn't want to get in trouble.
Just not tell Tony.
Right. So in this case, they're going to just not tell Angela. Now, Angela comes in to the kitchen. It's after work. She's loosening her tie.
Right, which I don't know what that outfit was. And it's like it's like a weird yellow. Would you say that's a suit?
No, or
it's just an outfit.
It's like a dress, right?
Yeah, and then there's this long silk tie.
Yes.
I'm not sure what was going on.
And
there.
And
it's polka dots.
She undoes it like a businessman coming home at the end of the day,
right,
loosening
like the tie
his tie
was real
around
tie
his neck. Yeah. Angela's already not in a good mood. Things didn't go well with Mr. Beeman.
And
Tony,
this plastic stuff.
Right, his plastic slip covers. Tony's like, hey, what happened to, hi, extended family, I'm home. And she just doesn't want to hear it. She's tired. How could anything else go wrong today? Well, she walks over to the cabinet, and she gets a glass out of it. And then she walks over to the sink, and she starts drying the glass with a towel.
Yeah, which is that Tony puts glasses away that are wet?
I know. I'm like, so either she thinks Tony's glasses are dirty or she thinks it's wet. But what I honestly think is that, like, a lot of times actors try to keep their hands busy. So maybe she just, like, walked over there and that was just, like, the first thing she thought to do. So, meanwhile, Tony had taken the hubcap, scooted it behind his back,
right,
and then put it in the refrigerator so that she wouldn't see it. But her next stop after the sink is the refrigerator, I guess, to get a glass of juice or maybe milk if she's really in a bad mood.
Right.
Not a drink, though.
No.
So Angela takes the hubcap out of the refrigerator and is like, what is this in the fridge? And at that moment, Mona comes in and she can recognize that this is a Mercedes hubcap.
Right. Yeah.
But I think she recognizes that something is up. And so she's like, oh, it's a Mercedes candy dish. And Angela's all upset, like, who ate all the candy?
Yeah, that was funny. That made me laugh. Well, she's like, but who ate all the candy?
Yes. But we're back. I mean, that's, you know, we're keeping up with this Angela and her sweet tooth, which is good continuity. So Tony's about to tell her the truth, and then he decides against it. And he's like, I ate all the candy, but I have more. Here. Dumps it into the candy dish and walks out the door. The doorbell rings, and it's the Oak Hills patrol officer at the door.
And never mind at this point that Angela's eating unwrapped candy out of a filthy hubcap.
Yes. I know.
Let's
it's like
keep that in mind.
He like threw dots in there or something.
Yeah,
I couldn't tell
like
what
open,
that kind of candy was.
Candy.
Right. Wasn't wrapped.
It was like dots or gummy bears, some kind of gummy thingy.
So the officer is played by James Hampton, and if he looks familiar, it's because he also played Herb in A Rash Decision. And again, is the dad from Teen Wolf.
Yeah.
One of my favorite childhood movies.
Yeah, that's pretty much the only thing I know him from.
Yeah.
I recognize
him. He's also in Sling Blade, but I don't remember him.
Oh.
Yeah. When we...
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. Yes.
You remember that you knew him from Sling Blade when we did the other
podcast. Right, and now
and then
it's
you
not in my notes.
Forgot.
So, right. Right. That's right. We did discuss that. Yes, I do remember him in Sling Blade.
So the officer's like, oh, that's a nice candy dish. I used to have a set of four just like it. Because it's actually the hubcaps. And he tells her that it's the hubcap from his car. So Tony's like, okay, well, here you go. You can have it back. Keep the candy. Thanks. And tries to get him to leave. But the officer's like, you know, earlier today, your son and another boy.
Dinkman.
Yes. Joey Dinkman took the hubcaps off my car. Took two of the hubcaps off my car. And at first, Angela can't believe it. She thinks it has to be a mistake, but Tony's kind of saying, like, no, it's not a mistake.
And at this point, he's eating candy now out of a filthy hubcap.
I know. The candy overrules any germs that would be on the inside of a car hubcap. So Angela's like, we're a good, upstanding family. We pay taxes. And she's like, we even belong to a country club. She's trying to get Mona on her side. And of course, Mona's zero help and is like, I don't know this woman.
Yeah, that was funny.
Now, as Angela realizes what's going on, that Tony knew about this and that he hadn't told her, she gets pretty angry. So the officer leaves with the hubcap and he's like, all right, well, you know, we'll let it slide this time. Just keep him out of trouble. Now, Mona's like, oh, you know, boys will be boys.
It's not like he knocked over 7-Eleven.
Right. And Tony gets in on this, oh, boys will be boys. But I like that Angela is not hearing the boys will be boys.
Yes.
And Jonathan's going to just, you know, be responsible for his actions as a human being and not have that excuse. So she calls him downstairs and Jonathan's like, I can't come downstairs because Tony told me to go to my room. And Mona's like, uh-oh. And you can tell that Angela's starting to feel rage at the fact that she really has no control over this situation here. So Jonathan comes down and he's still kind of looking to Tony if it's okay to sit when Angela tells him to sit. So Tony does tell him to sit and he does. And Angela goes back to the way she used to try to parent Jonathan, I think, before Tony got there, which is like, are you troubled? Like, why did you do this? Do you want more attention? Are you upset that I'm not home?
Right. He just says, I just wanted a hubcap.
Yeah. And Jonathan, you know, like, kids just do dumb things. And
yep.
But the other reason why he got this in his head is because Tony had told him a story about how he and Johnny Cha-Cha once took a street sign.
Yeah.
So this is, again, Jonathan, like, wanting to be like Tony because he idolizes him. And Angela's like, you stole a street sign? And he's like, not exactly. We moved it to a new, like, location.
Like a location.
Yeah. So this sign said easy access, and he tells the story that they moved, don't laugh at this joke, that they moved easy access, the easy access sign under Roseanne Lordesina's bedroom window.
No, Johnny Cha-Cha.
Yes. So, yeah, let's just focus on that name real quick, too. Roseanne Lordesina. That's an excellent name. And, again, like, I don't like this joke. And it's, again, it's 1985, whatever. But I think, like, today we wouldn't really see this joke because, one, it's slut-shaming Roseanne Lordesina. Like,
mm-hmm.
if she was having sex, then there were boys having sex with her, and nobody got the easy access under their sign bedroom windows. But Mona's like, oh, I bet that made her super popular.
Yeah.
Like, Mona's seeing
her social
this,
life or something.
Instead of Mona seeing like a teenage girl being embarrassed over having sex with people, she sees it as advertising. Like, this probably got her way more dates.
And Tony says, forget about it, Mona. Her stock soared.
Right. So Tony's already in trouble here. And now he's, what was that?
The cats. Okay. Somebody smashed their head on the table.
He's telling this story in front of a 9-year-old child.
I know. Well, I mean, never mind that.
Right. And so Jonathan's like, oh, I get it. And Angela says, no, you don't. So she sits Jonathan down. And I like this little part here where Tony and Mona lean in because they want to hear what's going to happen. And Angela gives them the look.
Like, I got this.
And they lean back. So she says to Jonathan, like, you know, we have a serious problem here. What should we do? And Jonathan's response is, send me to my room. I did the crime.
I'll do the time. Yeah, that's funny.
So Angela does, in fact, send Jonathan to his room.
Right. And then she doesn't like his response, and then Tony's like, I don't know where he picks up these things.
Right. It's from you.
Which is obviously from Tony.
Right. So you can see, like, I really feel for Angela here. I mean, not because of someone having a bad influence on my kids, but it's just that feeling of, like, you're trying to do your best, mm-hmm. and then you realize shit's gone sideways.
Yeah,
like, stuff
you have
is
no control.
Yeah, stuff. This is not working out the way you thought it was working out in your head, and I feel like she's really like holding a lot of guilt here. So Tony's like, "I'm sorry, you know, I sometimes kids get the wrong idea," and she's like, "No, it's my fault. Like, I should be raising my kid. I shouldn't have left it to someone else." And she's now letting that anger be put on Tony, and kind of unfairly and kind of in a mean way, where she's basically saying, like, I should be doing this and I shouldn't have left my kid with some guy who doesn't have good grammar, who's telling stories about stealing, who has a tattoo and, you know, outwardly looks like he could be a bad influence on Jonathan. And my favorite thing too is when she says he's talking like Sylvester Stallone.
I know.
Tony Danza is kind of like the TV Sylvester Stallone.
Yes, he is. Like, that's a good description.
Yeah. This is now another big fight between Tony and Angela. And Mona kind of tries to smooth things over, saying, like, you're at work all day. Tony's at home all day with the kids. You need to work as a team. And, like, that is something, you know, that a married couple would have to do. Mm-hmm. But it's funny that she's saying that when really he's the housekeeper, and, you know, they're not technically a family.
Right. And
Angela's not hearing any of it. She's like, I'm going to start, you know, running this office like a different office of Wallace McQuaid. I run the LA office, I run the Chicago office, so we'll consider this the Connecticut office. And as she leaves to go upstairs, she tells Tony, you are not the boy's father, I am.
Right, and at that point she goes upstairs and the banister shakes like there's an earthquake. Yeah. So it's like, yeah, that set looked like it could fall apart at any time.
I know. And like, there's a few times where Tony Danza slides down that thing, so they might want to reinforce that.
Yeah.
Yeah, TV sets. Now, she tells Tony that she's going to be consulted with every single thing that Jonathan does. And Tony's like, after Angela leaves, Tony tells Mona, like, that's ridiculous. Like, how am I supposed to, you know, contact her for everything? And Mona's realizing,
Mona has a plan.
Yes, that this is going to drive her nuts. And Mona says, give her what she wants. Yep. She's the boss.
Mm.
Now, the next day, it's Saturday, but Angela has to work because the Beeman campaign is not going well.
No, I know. We gotta nail this plastic couch thing down.
Right.
The Beeman. Silly.
Now, I like that we get a little glimpse here again of Angela's office. There are a couple things I noticed, and one is that she has a large horse behind her desk. And I'm thinking that Angela has a thing for horses, because if you look in the living room, there's also a horse, like, on the side table, like, on the above the fireplace, and I think even on the table behind the couch.
The living room is horse-centric. Yes.
And then the other thing I noticed is that there's a bust in Angela's office that looks like Princess Leia.
neither here nor there, but yes.
If you look at the bust at one point, like around the ears, it looks like the little buns. It totally looks like Princess Leia.
And you know how Angela is at work and she means business is the size of the glasses.
Right, yes. She has her intense glasses.
Man, those glasses are, yes. It's about 35% to 40% of her face. Right.
And very large earrings that she has to take off to answer the phone.
Yes.
You know, when they're like, they must be clip-ons, but what's funny is
they come right off.
So I dressed our daughter up as Angela Bauer and we did a little photo shoot. And I had bought her large earrings, but she couldn't hold the phone with the earring on. So I actually only put one earring on her for the photo shoot, because the earrings are way too big to use a phone anyway. So that's why she does it. Now the phone rings and it's Tony. He has a question. Can Jonathan have a mid-morning snack? And Angela's like, well, when did he eat lunch? And he's like, well, that's another thing. When should I serve him lunch? And she's like, well, give him a snack now, and then in a couple hours, give him lunch. And he's like, thanks, coach. This is great. Hangs up the phone. So we've got... What are you doing?
I was moving Avi's phone, and then it, like, came alive, and TikTok started playing. I'm sorry.
Stop over there. So Mr. Beeman comes in, and the other thing is, so there's another man in the office, Howie Mendelson, who's played by Howie Stevens. And for the first, like, 3 minutes of the scene, he doesn't speak, so he's just standing there.
Right, doing nothing. Right. But you know what? Hang on another side note, though. Yeah. I love how when Tony calls to ask if Jonathan can have a snack, Mona's right there, like, oh, yeah, she's in on it.
Oh yeah,
I mean, she's, I know this was all her plan.
Yeah,
but I just love how they're working together, right, to kind of to dig at Angela.
Yeah,
it's kind of funny.
She wants to hear the confusion and then agitation in Angela's voice,
because she knows that Tony's not right necessarily, but like that maybe she wants to point out to Angela she's being a little ridiculous.
Right.
You know,
yes,
there's got to be a middle ground somewhere. Yeah, here.
Absolutely. So Mr. Beeman comes in.
Dressed like an idiot. I don't know what he's got, a bolo tie, a cowboy hat.
Yeah.
And but it's his full suit.
Yes. And he's not happy with Wallace McQuaid at all. So
No.
That's why she's there, to work out a campaign with him. And Mr. Beeman has terrible ideas. So at some point, Howie finally speaks. And I just want to say that the actor of... the character Howie is played by Howard Stevens. He hasn't acted since 1999. He did a few just stints on 80s show. He has a familiar look to his face, but there was really nothing that I could find that he would be known for.
Yeah.
And then Mr. Beeman is played by Claude Earl Jones. Again, you know, he was on Dallas for a bit. He did...
Maybe that explains the cowboy hat and the bolo tie. Yeah.
He kept it. Oh, he was on Little House on the Prairie, which is another one of my favorites as a kid.
Yeah.
But he stopped acting in 1997, and he passed away in 2019 at the age of 86.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Mr. Beeman has terrible ideas. His slogan is basically Beeman flip covers. Buy them.
Like, right, buy my plastic.
Buy my plastic covers. And I'm going to show you the factory where we make the covers. So Angela's already not having a great day. Now, the phone rings again, and she has to explain to Mr. Beeman that it's Saturday, so her secretary isn't there, so she needs to answer the phone. And it's Tony again. It appears we don't hear Tony's end of the conversation now, but it sounds like he's asking if Jonathan can have an apple or a banana.
Right. And meanwhile, to Mr. Beeman, it's supposed to be the Connecticut office that she's talking to. Yes. Like, just give him a banana. Right. And he's sitting there like, what are they talking about?
She does say there was an issue at the Connecticut office.
Right.
And it's like he asks if he can have an apple and then tells her that they don't have any. So then she has to suggest the banana.
Right. I think they're just messing with her.
Yeah. So, again, she sits down, tries to have this meeting with Mr. Beeman, and the phone rings again.
Of course.
Now we don't hear Tony's side of the story, but it sounds like Jonathan has hiccups.
Right. Yes.
She asks him all the stuff that he's tried, and then finally she's like, okay, put him on, and screams boo into the phone. I think that's my favorite part of the episode.
Yeah, that's really funny. Is that supposed to be the Connecticut office? Like, yeah, what's happening?
Right. Someone at the Connecticut office has hiccups, and they need her help.
It's close to my favorite part of the episode.
Oh, yeah.
That's right there with Samantha punching. Samantha completely attacking Jonathan.
All right, so back at home, Tony's dusting the crown molding by jumping on a trampoline, wiping as much of the molding as he can.
Spraying it with some spray.
Yeah, he's like going up, spraying it, then going up, wiping it. But see, this is total Tony Micelli because he's getting a workout in while he is cleaning the house.
Good point.
Yeah, I mean, you don't look like that without fitting a workout in at least 3 times a day, right?
There's no ladder anywhere in this house for you to use a trampoline. I mean, that makes total sense. Bring a trampoline into the house.
And I guess Tony works Saturday. I mean, Tony's already working, obviously, because he's taking care of the children, but he's also still cleaning the house on the Saturday. Tony's basically a parent.
Yeah.
He's not a housekeeper.
No, he never has off.
Right, no. He's mom or dad. So there's a part here where if you look closely, he kind of drops the can down onto the trampoline, but then in the next shot, the can's back in his hand. Mm. That's a little blooper. So
yeah, we don't, I'll be honest with you, I don't think, and we watch, when we do every episode, we'll watch it 2 or 3 times.
Mm-hmm.
We don't see a lot of continuity problems or like that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's an interesting thing about the show. Like, either that or we don't notice them.
Well, and I think, too, because it's a sitcom. So they're shot so fast.
I know, but that would also sometimes cause continuity issues where somebody's holding something, now it's on the table, now it's
yeah,
back.
I guess,
you know what
so.
I mean?
Like, yeah. But it kind of runs like a play. So I feel like,
you're saying it's shot so fast that it's not as many takes.
Right, yeah. And especially this show, they didn't do a lot of takes. It was
it's like rip through it.
Yeah, go through it. Because they, according to one of the E! True Hollywood Stories or something I listened to, he wanted to be done because he didn't want to keep an audience there for that long. Mm. And he wanted to be able to have dinner with his family. So they would really like power through it as soon as they got started. To the point where Katherine Hellman and Judith Light used to have contests to see who could get changed the fastest because they would always have the most extensive costume changes and Angela's hair changes.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, they would have they would race to get done first. So anyway, so Jonathan comes in, asks Tony, he wants to go play with Joey Dingman.
Oh,
and Tony says no. But Jonathan gets sneaky here, so he decides to go into the kitchen, and he calls Angela, and he asks her if he can play with his friend, and she doesn't know any better.
That's
so
pretty freaking sneaky.
Yeah, so she says yes. That's like when your kid, asks mom, and mom says no, and then you go ask dad, and dad says yes.
Yeah.
Or the other way around. Angela gets home later that day, and Mona is watching a movie.
Well, she's listening to the McNeil Lehrer report, according to her.
Right, yes. But she's watching a movie that she knows all the words to. And again, I wonder if those voices are like crew members doing the actors' voices on the TV show.
Well, even one of our kids, when we were rewatching this episode, they thought it was Mona's voice.
Oh, yeah. They did think that one of the voices was actually Katherine Hellman. Now, you notice this. Why is the TV on the coffee table?
Right. I mean, there's several things wrong with this scene.
Yeah.
The coffee table, the television's on the coffee table, like it's just a little television. She's holding a
watering can.
Right, which I guess maybe she was in the middle of watering all the plants right. that are not in the living room.
Right, when she decided to start watching this movie.
And so...
And she knows all the lines to the movie, so it obviously is something that had been on, you know.
That she shouldn't have been watching, apparently.
Right. Yeah. But I guess TVs were just so small, you could move them anywhere, you know?
I guess.
You don't want to reach over, just prop it right on the...
They weren't, aren't we...
Well, yes, TV, that when TV I
was a
kid, is small.
It was like a piece of furniture. Well, yeah, you didn't move
that
it.
That was a console, but tremendous. They clearly don't have a console, so they must just have like a 19-inch that you can move around, I
you
guess.
Think Angela would have a fancy television.
That's true, but Angela doesn't have time to watch TV. No. So when Angela comes in, Mona says she's watching the McNeil-Lehrer report.
Yeah, sorry, like a spoiler. I already spoiled that.
No, I mean, yeah, big spoiler. People were waiting for that reveal. And it was an old PBS show, and the only thing I remember about that is one time for college I had an assignment where we had to watch that show, and I could not get through it.
It's the most boring thing
you've
ever seen
in your
life. It was
so boring. And, like, I love NPR now, so I don't know if it was just that I was 20.
Yeah, you're old now, so you might like it.
Right? Or if it was really that boring. So Angela says they saved the account. And they saved the account by going with Beeman's slogan of buy Beeman furniture covers.
That's like, what they came up with working all weekend.
Right, yeah. She wasted a Saturday in the office. She wasted that outfit. She wasted the hairspray she used on her hair. Like, she could have just said yes to him over the phone. The doorbell rings.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And it's the Oak Hills Patrol officer again.
The rent-a-cop. Is it okay to say rent-a-cop?
I don't think so.
Okay, I should stop saying that.
I mean, it is insulting. I don't, you know.
Yeah.
If there are any people who work as a security guard or a patrol officer listening to this podcast, which I'm going to say no, they would be offended.
I know, but what if they are? You're right.
Right.
I should not say that.
So he wants to know where Jonathan is. And he... says he basically references Butch and Sundance.
Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
Is that a movie?
Yeah, it was a movie that had Paul Newman, Robert Redford in it.
I think I have heard of that.
Yeah, it was a Western film. But I mean, it's based loosely on fact. The film tells the story of a Wild West Outlaws, Robert Leroy Parker, known as Butch Cassidy, played by Paul Newman, and his partner Harry, I'm going to probably mess these names up, Harry Longenbaugh, as the Sundance Kid, played by Robert Redford. So anyway, that's enough.
So basically they rob Butch people. Cassidy. They steal things.
Yes.
Got it.
Which again plays into the whole episode, which there was a Jesse James reference.
Right. So the patrol officer says that at 4:37 p.m., I wrote that down. Why?
I don't know.
Two kids broke into an elementary school. One was Joey Dinkman.
Oh, the Dink.
A.K.A. the Dink. It's so funny. That's a great
Dink
name. And the description of the other boy matches your son. And he's like, you know, the hubcaps are one thing, but they actually, like, graffiti the school, and this is...
Yeah,
you know.
Who was the mock Jonathan?
I know,
who
right?
Who was the child that looked like?
It just happens to be some other little kid
Dink's
with a bowl
haircut.
Dink's
got other little blonde hair,
running around.
Bowl cut kid friends. The Dink.
I hope it wasn't Bobby, that's all. Mm. So, you know, he's like, now we're going to have to call the real cops in. And Mona says...
The cops with bullets, I think she says.
But and Mona's like, well, he didn't go because Tony said he couldn't go play with the Dink.
Mm-hmm. So, actually, I have a question. Does the Dink come back in later on? You would know.
No.
This is the Dink's only appearance.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. I didn't know. Like, sometimes there's a recurring.
Yes. Yeah.
And I'm so unfamiliar. I mean, not unfamiliar, but you're way more familiar with the show than me. I didn't know if the Dink comes back.
Yeah, we'll never see Joey Dinkman.
It's probably a good thing.
As far as I know, I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think so.
Okay.
So,
be interesting if we do.
Yes. So Mona said that he didn't go because Tony said that he couldn't play with him. But Angela's like, oh no, Jonathan called me and then I said that he could go. So she thinks that it was Jonathan.
Right. At some point, Tony must have cut him off of the path.
Yeah. So he must have you know, said, I don't think he would have been dumb enough to say, "Mommy said I could go." He probably just was like sneaking out and Tony caught him and then told him he had to come back. So Tony overruled her and he did not go. Mm-hmm. So he's upstairs in his room. He didn't get into trouble. Upstairs, Tony goes in to see if Jonathan's still mad at him. And I just want to spend a little bit of time in Jonathan's room.
I know. So for our first look.
Yeah. Right? It was our first look at Jonathan's room. And the set dressing is very detailed. Like, it I feel is. Like Samantha's room is kind of bare. And that makes sense. Well,
Samantha's room, I have a little tiny bit of experience in set dressing. Mm-hmm. Samantha's room looks like we have to fill these walls, which happens a lot in movies and stuff. Like, we got to put some stuff on these walls, find stuff that's cleared that can be on the walls. And so, like, there was that police poster, which actually I'm surprised they got clearance on that.
That's true.
Stuff like that's not cheap. But, in his room, yes, I know what you're saying. It seems like...
The other thing, too, is, like, Samantha moved into the sewing room, and they've only been there probably not even 6 months. She didn't have a whole lot of stuff. So maybe as the years go on, she'll decorate that room more to be her room. But it looks to me that it's, like, still decorations left over from when it was the sewing room. Okay. Like, the balloons on the wall and the Raggedy Ann. Like, I don't think that's Samantha's stuff.
Oh, that's a good observation.
And maybe at this point she hasn't really taken it over as her own.
But... And Jonathan's been there a while, so his room is very involved.
Right. So Jonathan's room. Okay. There's a poster sheet of baseball cards.
Which I think is fantastic.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome.
I had one... When I was younger, my father actually collected baseball cards more than I really did. I mean, we both did. But I remember my dad purchased a few rolls of baseball cards, and they were like the size of a huge poster. And it was uncut.
It's really cool.
Like before they cut them up, baseball cards. Yeah. I'm sure he still has them.
Then what looks like Danny Pintauro's headshot on the one wall.
Yeah, that's pretty fantastic.
Above a framed photo of two dachshunds. The lamp is a toy soldier lamp. Mm-hmm. There's some giant yellow sunglasses on his nightstand.
Sorry, my notes are making a lot of noise right now.
The headboard's covered with dinosaurs, which makes sense. There's a lion poster over the bed. Mm-hmm. Then there's a stuffed Dalmatian on one of the chairs. There's another set of shelves on the wall, where you can see a Darth Vader action figure carrier, which is pretty cool.
Which I owned.
Yes, it's awesome.
We had that, me and my brother.
A rainbow lamp that I want right now.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
And some oversized crayons. Like, it's really dressed. And then we also get to see that he now has what appears to be a hamster or a guinea pig. Mm-hmm. It looks too small to be a guinea pig, but the hair looks too long to be a hamster. But I don't really know much about those.
Wasn't there a snake and some other reptiles?
They're all dead
now.
Wilbur got the boot, and then the boa constrictor, I'm guessing, also got the boot. Maybe Angela sent that with Michael when he went back to Zimbabwe or whatever, wherever he went. So... Tony comes in and he explains, you know why I couldn't let you play with Joey Dinkman. And as they're talking, Angela comes upstairs and she's listening at the door. So Tony tells Jonathan, I'm the only housekeeper on this street that doesn't shave their legs. Except for Vivian. But he's like, do you think that I care what people say about me?
Poor Vivian gets thrown under the bus.
Yeah. He's like, do you think that I care about what people say about me? And Jonathan's like, yeah, but you are a tough guy and you have a tattoo and, you don't need to be scared to say no to stuff. And Tony says, like, this tattoo is a perfect example of when I was too scared and I went and got a tattoo, even though maybe he didn't really want it because he didn't want, his friends to think that he was a chicken. And he's like, at some point, you're going to have to just... have the friends that you have who will like you for who you are, not what you do, and not care about what other people think of you. Now, at this point, I think Angela's like watching the conversation, and I'm pretty sure we're seeing when she falls in love with Tony.
Yeah, I mean, when she's creeping at the door.
I know. Like, she had to have fallen in love with him just a little bit. Mm-hmm. Just watching this, like, it's basically a cute father-son moment.
Yeah, that's my, I'm sorry. No, no, it's okay. You're absolutely right. It's like a tone is Tony's daddy moment with Jonathan. Yeah. And like, she realizes, oh, he is like a true father figure to him, which Jonathan doesn't have.
Right. And like, she knows that even though Tony's rough around the edges and doesn't have the best education and, you know, probably got into a lot of trouble in school, that he has a really good heart. And he always has Jonathan's best interest, you know, there. Both of, you know, kids, obviously his daughter as well. So I think she realizes that she was rash at, like, thinking that he's a bad influence on him. So Angela comes in, makes her appearance known, and says, you also want friends who will forgive you when you're a jerk, when you say things that you don't mean. Mm-hmm. And Tony's like, and you want friends that'll, you need to know when to keep your mouth shut telling stories, basically saying that he shouldn't have told Jonathan those stories to begin with. Mm-hmm. And now they're clearly talking to each other. So
right. And apologizing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a really cute moment. I mm-hmm. think it's like just a really sweet little family moment between the three of them. And we finally got to see a little more of Jonathan, who we haven't really seen that much.
Yeah, they keep him under wraps.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess it's harder when the kids are smaller like mm-hmm. that. Like, he's 9. It's got to be difficult working with a 9-year-old kid as opposed to Alyssa Milano, who's like 12 here. It's probably easier. But yeah. So they all have that super cute moment. And later that night, Angela and Tony are in the living room. And she's like, you know, I've even had my impulses of silly childhood things. And she tells this ridiculous story about how one time at Miss Prescott's day school, she changed Miss Prescott's calendar, ripped the day off her calendar. So she thought it was Tuesday all day, even though it was Monday.
Living on the edge.
And Tony's just like, can I go to bed now?
Mm-hmm.
And then he does a little prank on her. He says she has something on her shirt, and then he does a little boop on her nose. And that's the end. Okay, so let's do rating first. You go first.
Okay. I gave this a 7.5, 7.5.
Nice.
I thoroughly enjoyed this episode, like, overall.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was good. It held my attention.
Yeah. I liked it more than I thought I was going to. Mm-hmm. I gave it an 8.
Okay.
I just really thought it was cute moments between Jonathan and Tony, a good fight between Angela and Tony.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Angela trying to take over the situation.
Right.
Yeah, it was good. And realizing she's losing control.
Yeah. Yeah, and I felt for Angela when she was feeling that rage of, I don't know what's going on here.
Yeah.
And there was also some good movement, I think, on their friendship, which was sweet.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe a little bit of falling in love.
On the romance.
Yeah.
Front.
Who's the boss around here, me? Or my mother? Or maybe it's you!
I'll go first. I think Tony is the boss of this episode.
Oh, okay.
And it's because, you know, he made some missteps at the beginning, but then he really proved that he does have a handle on things and that he has Jonathan's best interests at heart and that Angela really cannot run the Connecticut office. Like, she has enough on her plate. And she needs to be able to not micromanage and let him, you know, take care of stuff at home.
Okay. I actually agree with you. That's
nice.
Who I have as the boss, too.
Nice.
And for those reasons. And also, just in the end, it shows that Tony really does know what's going on. And he has, like you said, Jonathan's best interest in mind. And the fact that Mona pretty much backed him up.
Yeah.
You know, and knowing that, hey, Angela, you need to relax. Tony's got this under control. It's
right.
Okay. You know.
Right.
Yeah, there was a misstep. He came home with a hubcap for some reason, but because he wanted it. But you know.
Oh, we almost made it.
I know, we almost made
it. Yeah.
You know, but basically he righted the ship, and I think that I was actually a little torn. I almost picked Mona as the boss.
Yeah, I would say she's the assistant. Only because
she was guiding, you know what I mean? She was steering Tony in the right direction a little bit and trying to help out.
Yeah,
but I don't think she was in the episode enough.
She's assistant manager. To justify manager. Her
being the boss. So I would say Tony's the boss. I agree.
Right, what did Dwight always call himself? Assistant to the regional manager?
Well, I think he would call him assistant regional manager, and then Mike would always say, somebody else would have, Jim would always point out assistant to the regional manager or something like that. Our dog really wants to go outside.
Let me pause. Okay, we're back. Do you have a song?
Yeah, I do. This is Andrew Schwant playing all of the instruments, the alto, tenor, and is it barry sax?
Yeah, baritone sax.
Baritone, okay. You're the band person here. The
band nerd.
All right, I didn't want to say nerd. And flute, shaker, and ashtray.
I don't know what an ashtray is, so I think he's maybe really tapping on an ashtray. Yeah,
but it's him playing all of those instruments, and it's actually really good. Enjoy it.
Awesome.
If you like this podcast, please subscribe and tell all your friends and give you a big pat on the back.